Okay, before we read Emily Dickinson's poetry, let's get acquainted with her a little bit. You probably have seen this image before, and you've probably heard her name. She's a very, very famous poet, Emily Dickinson. And so let's talk about her a little bit. A little bit about her life. She grew up in Amherst, Massachusetts. Very, very beautiful place. You could actually still visit there today, her house. She led an incredibly private life. She was said to only have left Amherst 3 times in her life. So she definitely stayed, she was a homebody. She stayed at home and didn't, venture out too much. She never married. And by the way, there are some interesting theories about that. I think there was just recently a TV show, I think on Apple TV, about Emily Dickinson. And so there are some interesting theories about that. But the fact is, she never married. Her passion was her poetry, of course, and her garden. She liked to be home, but she also liked to be outdoors within her home, if that makes sense. So her garden was big for her. And then this is an interesting one. She would also sit and watch the graveyard. So she often would be outside. And I don't know. I guess I kind of see this because there's something peaceful about a graveyard, even though some people have kind of creepy feelings about it. There is something really, really, really peaceful about sitting in a graveyard. And so that was something that she enjoyed. And that probably influenced some of her writings about death. Right, she wrote quite a bit about death, and so probably sitting out in a graveyard looking at tombstones will do that to you. A little bit about her poetry. She was actually afraid her poetry would not be accepted because of its unconventional style, and I'll talk about why it was unconventional in a minute. But she was afraid that nobody was going to like it, that she would not be approved because of the way that she wrote. She actually wrote over 1,700 poems, but only 7 were published while she was alive. So she did not pursue publishing or publication during her lifetime. In fact, she didn't really want her poems out there for the world. She wanted her poems burned upon her death. But her sister went against her wishes, went against her death wish, and published them instead. So the reason why we have Emily Dickinson's poetry today is because her sister was a total rebel and didn't listen. Some things that she liked to write about. She wrote a lot about fear. She wrote about frustration. Those are pretty common ones for all poets. But death was a big one that she wrote about. God, she was spiritual, she was religious, and so she wrote about God. Friendships, although she honestly did not have very many, but she wrote about friendship. Love and nature, of course. She wrote quite a bit about nature and the peace and kind of tranquility that comes with nature. Her poetry style and the reason why it's unconventional. She uses some really odd punctuation and capitalization, so she doesn't necessarily follow the traditional rules of English language. In particular, she used a lot of dashes at the ends of her lines, and so she was afraid that people would not, I don't know, appreciate it and might look like she didn't know what she was doing, or I don't know, but she was concerned about the way that that would look. But that's what makes her poetry a little bit unconventional, especially for the time. She used a lot of figurative language. There are a lot of similes, a lot of metaphors, a lot of alliteration, and all sorts of stuff. Sometimes she describes simply what she sees. So her poetry could be very surface level and just say, "Hey, here is a poem about this tree I'm looking at, and it's beautiful." Or other times she makes comparison and she's searching for meaning. And so she might be observing something, but then ultimately trying to think about how to make meaning out of what she's looking at. A lot of her poetry, like I said, is about nature. One of the poems you're going to read is called "Some Keep the Sabbath Going to Church." And so that is all about finding God in nature, very transcendental idea. She, like I said, sees God's presence in all of nature. And she also sees nature as a friend. So she often personifies nature and natural beings like animals and such. Because she does see nature as literally like a friend. Okay? So you are going to start by reading I'm Nobody, Who Are You by Emily Dickinson. Okay, so if you're on the second page of your packet, then you should see something that looks like what I have on my screen here. Okay, we are going to explicate, which means we're going to analyze in detail the first poem together. It's called I'm Nobody, Who Are You? In order to explicate the poem, we're going to follow 6 steps. And you can see those 6 steps right here. I'm sorry, right
right here. Okay, let's start with step number one. It says identify the speaker and the subject that is being spoken of, or to whom or what. So we're looking for who's speaking to whom, and we're looking for what's the general topic of the poem. In order to do that, you pretty much need to read through it at least once. Okay, so let's go ahead and start by reading through this poem. It's not very long, as you can see. It's called I'm Nobody, Who Are You? I'm nobody, who are you? Are you nobody too? Then there's a pair of us, don't tell, they'd banish us, you know. How dreary to be somebody, how public, like a frog, to tell your name the livelong day to an admiring bog. Okay, so we can start by at least identifying the speaker and who's being spoken to. The speaker, we can see, is I, right? I'm the speaker. Okay, and who is I? Okay, the person, who is I speaking to? Well, we've got a you as well, okay? So I is a general kind of speaker there. It could represent Emily Dickinson, most likely it does. And then who are you is the listener or the reader. The general topic that's being spoken of, we can identify this idea of being nobody, okay? Nobody, this idea of is it better to be nobody or somebody? So there's our topic, right? Okay, if we go back to the top up here where it says the six steps, now we're going to, let me change my color really quickly. Now we're going to circle relevant verbs or actions. So we're going to be looking for verbs that are powerful, okay? Powerful verbs. So let's go ahead and read this again. I am nobody, who are you? Okay, technically our verbs here are am, right there, and are, who are you? Are you nobody too? Again, it's all about the verb to be, right? Is who are you is our big verb here. Who are you? That's our big verb, to be, right? Then there's a pair of us, don't tell. Once again, there's the word is in there, right? Those are usually not that powerful when it comes to verbs. However, the word is and are and to be, because it's just a sense of being, I think it's pretty important. Don't tell, tell would be another powerful verb there. They'd banish us. I think this right here is probably our first really powerful verb there. They'd banish us, you know. How dreary to be somebody. I'm only gonna do that one again because we've got that multiple times. We've got I am nobody, who are you nobody too, then there is a pair of us. How dreary to be somebody. Again, we've got this really, this repeated verb here, to be. How public like a frog, to tell your name the livelong day. We've got another verb that's repeated there, to tell your name the livelong day to an admiring bog. So we really only have three verbs here. The verb to be, the verb banish, which is really powerful, and the verb to tell. Okay, to tell. And notice that to tell, is that a positive or a negative thing? That's generally a negative thing, right? Don't tell, it says do not tell. And then over here, to tell your name, and it's talking about how dreary it is, how public to tell. So this, in general, this verb here is a negative verb. And so is the word banish as well, right? We've got two negative verbs, banish and to tell is negative in this context. Okay, the next step, if we look up again, right over here, we've got identify what images are conveyed next to the stanzas. Consider the connotations of the author's diction or word choice. Okay, so now we're going to be looking for images. So let's scroll back down. I've got I'm nobody, who are you? Are you nobody too? Then there's a pair of us, don't tell, they banish us, you know. We could maybe identify that this idea of nobody kind of feels like nothing, so there's this image of nothing here. So we can, if we want to, write that down as an image. I'm okay with that. I'm gonna switch colors, actually. So we've got image over here of nothing, right? Nothingness. I'm gonna put ness over there too. So we've got an image of nothingness here. Okay, let's look at the second stanza though, because I think there's a more powerful image there, even more powerful image. It says, how dreary to be somebody, how public, like a frog, to tell your name the livelong day to an admiring bog. So here we've got an image, like a frog to an admiring bog. Now maybe you don't know what that word bog means, and so that might be one that we have to look up. In fact, that's our next step. But right now I'm just gonna add, I took a little photo here. So here's my little photo of a frog. And again, you may not know what exactly a bog is. In fact, that's the next step that we're going to do. Step number four, again, if you look up here, it says look up or Google it, any unfamiliar words or references and write it next to or above the word. So let's go ahead and look up bog because I think a lot of us maybe don't know that word. Oops, I'm going to push define. And bog. We've got wet, muddy ground, too soft to support a heavy body. Okay, so it's like a marsh or a swamp, excuse me. But it's important that it says too soft to support a heavy body. So let's go back over here. And now we've got a new word to define here. I'm going to do that in red. Okay, so a bog. Okay, so now if we go back and look at that image, now that we understand what a bog is, we've got that image of like a frog to an admiring bog, right? So think about that again as an image. If we look at this right here, we've got a frog in a bog, okay? A frog that's struggling to stay afloat, that's struggling to survive in something that's pulling it down, that's not able to support its weight. So that's the image we've got here. Not a very positive image here. Okay, so the last thing that we're supposed to do in step number, oh, I'm sorry, we're on step five. Step number five says, note any shift in the subject matter or perspective. Let's read this one more time. I'm nobody. Who are you? Are you nobody too? Well, then there's a pair of us. Don't tell. They'd banish us, you know. I think already right here we've got a shift where it says, then there's a pair of us right here. Okay, there's a pair of us right here. So there's a shift right there. How dreary to be somebody, how public like a frog. So now we've shifted, there's a huge shift right here from nobody to now somebody, right? However, the idea is still the same. I'm nobody. Who are you? She's excited about that fact. Are you nobody too? Then there's a pair of us. Don't tell. They banish us, you know. How dreary to be somebody. So now, again, it's a shift, but we're really talking about the same type of thing. I'm excited to be nobody. And it's kind of a bummer. It's dreary to be somebody, right? Okay, and then the last step six, is to answer any additional questions below the poem. Before we do that though, oh, actually, let's do that. It says, explain what poetic devices are used in the poem. Note the line and explain, for instance, don't just say metaphor. Explain what two unlike things are being compared in the metaphor. Well, we actually identified the main image as the frog, right? Like a frog. So since it's like a frog, we know that's not just a metaphor. That is a simile. So down here, we're going to write in that that is our simile. I'm going to write it in a better color here, maybe a dark blue. Okay, so we do have a simile, but once again, I can't just identify that it is a simile. We have to identify what's being compared here. Oops, okay. How dreary to be somebody, how public, like a frog to an admiring bog, to tell your name the livelong day. So to be public, we're comparing being public to a frog that is struggling to stay afloat. Okay, so we're comparing being public, being a part of society, I could even say that, right? Being a part of society is like a frog that's struggling to stay afloat in a bog. So we can kind of, at this point, understand that the point of her poem here is that being public, being a part of society is a struggle, that it doesn't feel natural, it doesn't feel good. It feels like they're against you. So now when it says explain what messages the poem seemed to convey, well, we kind of just did that. We've got a couple things we can say. We could say the folly, that's a word you might not know, but the pointlessness of seeking fame. And then maybe we can add this, that it's a lot of work to be somebody. And I added this as well, that they have to spend their time proclaiming how great they are, right? It's tiring to be somebody, to participate in society, because you constantly have to try and prove yourself. Okay, the last part says, fill in and complete the thought. The author uses blank diction, and I believe this because, okay? So diction has to do with word choice. So let's go back up and look at our word choice. There was only one word that we didn't know. And to be honest, in the 1800s, that would have been a word that most people knew. So are there any really fancy words in this? Okay, maybe dreary is kind of a fancy word. I don't know if you consider that a fancy word. But for the most part, we've got really simple words here, right? Really simple words. So I am going to, right here, I'm going to use, when it comes to diction, Emily Dickinson uses informal. You could also write to the point diction. And I believe this because, well, she doesn't use a lot of flowery language or words that are large. Everything is short and to the point. Right there, that she doesn't use a lot of flowery language or words that are large. Everything is short and to the point.